Dear Minister, dear colleagues, Katharina, I think it's a big pleasure to be here, to see so many people interested in what we are doing. This will be a little perhaps more down to earth, what you will hear now. A good speaker. I mean, in the Commission, of course, I think there's a lot of things also ongoing in relation to innovation. Minister, you did not mention, I mean, at the moment, for example, on our side, is of course, and we'll see how this develops, is the whole discussion about the European Innovation Council. To see how this works. I mean, in the future, in the proposal now for Horizon Europe, I mean, there is really big chunk of money also proposed in order to do work on this. But I mean, what I will try to speak a little about AG Innovate. And just two words, okay, so I'm working in DG Education. So this is also important, also. I'm not working in DG Research. We have a lot of contact with DG Research. In my former life, I mean, I did some research. I worked also in DG Connect. So more from the IT side on the research programs, but at the moment I'm really working on the educational side. And I think if we speak about innovation, I think we speak about people. And this is, I think, where education has really, I mean, a very, very big role, a big responsibility to play. And the point is, of course, okay, we have developed this guiding framework, and I think it's something which is really interesting, and we are also surprised by the, how to say, the interest it has created and how it's taken up by the universities. Now, okay, this is where we come from. I mean, again, so we are in education. When we looked at our programs, what we saw is that in our, at this time it was a lifelong learning program, now we have the Erasmus Plus program, we did not really see higher education institutions working together at that side with companies. And companies really seen in the large sense. So it's not just about profit making. We speak about working together with hospitals. We speak about working with museums. We speak about working with NGOs and so on. So really opening up so the universities engage with the environment around. So see this more effectively happening. And of course, if you look at some countries where this works, or let's say this is more happening, I think it has a very positive impact on the education, on the learning experience of the students. And this is why we said, okay, what can we do on European level? And this is why we created a sort of platform where we bring together stakeholders from higher education, from business, but also, of course, public authorities, regional authorities, and so on. And this, in these discussions, I mean, all the time what came up, of course, okay, what can we do, I mean, to help our graduates and to make, I mean, them, what we say, more entrepreneurial. And again, I mean, when we know, when we speak about entrepreneurial, sometimes it's a sort of connotated word, not always seen in a positive light, but I think we really see it positively, because when we speak about being entrepreneurial, we think really about the skills people need now in order in the future to be able to adapt and also to shape a little their life. And then also to adapt in particular, I mean, many jobs that you have in the future, they don't exist today. So people will be necessarily have to have these sort of kinds and competences in order, you know, to adapt to environment and see, of course, how they can manage this. So we started about, okay, what can we do with this entrepreneurial thing? And then the discussion came out, and we saw also that the universities, of course, they play a key role. They play a key role for innovation. We are convinced about it. But then, okay, how can you do it? And this is where we had several sessions on this in this forum. It was also about how to create these entrepreneurial and innovative higher education institutions. And again, I mean, this should not be understood in the very narrow sense. When we speak about entrepreneurial and innovative higher education institutions, it's really about how we're building this, you know, this mindset. And I mean, there we had a lot of discussions, and what we saw is very often it was very, I mean, limited to universities were seen as entrepreneurial if they had startups, if they had patents, and this kind of thing. And this is, I mean, was much too narrow for us. This is one important dimension, but for us it's a much bigger picture. And this is when we had the session, we had some discussions, and afterwards we will hear Paul Hannon, and we had some discussions, yeah, what can we do on European level? And this is how the idea came up to come with a guiding framework, more or less, what we understand, what we can understand about such entrepreneurial, innovative higher education institution. And this is how it was really launched in 2011, AG Innovate. And we set up a group of experts, we worked together, we had pilots and so on. In 2013, we had the first lunch and so on. And I think it's really, I mean, a quite big story. Now, this is also, I mean, something when we speak about the entrepreneurial higher education institution, what do we mean about it? And this is something we took up at that point in time from Alan Gibb, who is a researcher in the UK at Durham University. He did quite some substantial work also together, I think, with Paul, on entrepreneurship. And I think this is then afterwards what we thought, okay, how, what do we see behind or understand an entrepreneurial innovative higher education institutions. And I think one thing is really about to empower students and staff to demonstrate what is their enterprise, innovation, creativity in teaching, research, and the third mission. And I think it's an important point, how to connect this, how to bring these things together. I think, I mean, you know my universities very well, but I think what we often see, I think there's a very strong separation still. I mean, it's too big between research, education, and the third mission. It's seen as three different things, and I think we have to see how we can strongly, I mean, integrate this. Then what we see is, of course, it's about knowledge, I mean, enhancing learning. It's about knowledge production, what was said. And then, of course, how to work together with this environment that we have around the higher education institutions. And it's about, I mean, this we heard, of course, about creating public value. Now, this is at the moment HG Innovate, how it looks like, because it's really quite a journey. We have started 2011, and I mean, it's really ongoing. It's a whole process. And I will go afterwards a little more into detail on the different components. So on one side, we really developed this tool, which is available on the internet, which is HG Innovate, and which is targeted at the individual higher education institutions. And what I didn't say, when we started this initiative in 2011, 2012, we saw that the OECD, they did some similar work in this. They have started to go into some countries, into some regions, see a little how, you know, the higher education institutions in that field operated. And then we said, okay, if you do something similar, let's try and join forces. And this is since 2012, we worked together with the OECD in the development and implementation of the tool. And one of the strengths, of course, of the OECD is also doing this country reviews, analytical work, look into it. And this is where we started to pilot also then country reviews based on this HG Innovate methodology, and a little afterwards. And now just recently we started also, of course, now we start to have some learnings to bring together policymakers, but also representatives from higher education institutions to develop a sort of learning platform, so where the people can get together, where can they exchange good practices and develop then also new things. Because, of course, we see also that the issues, the problems that exist are very similar in the member states and in the different regions. So now about the self-assessment tool. And now it's perhaps a little technical, whatever, but I think it's important to say is, of course, what we want to have really this holistic, this broad approach. And when we look at how to develop this innovative or entrepreneurial higher education institutions. And this is, after discussion, at the beginning, we started with seven dimensions, but really said, if you look at this, you cannot just look at the startups. You have to look at the bigger picture, and there we started governance, leadership, so how this is addressed in it. Organizational capacity, the entrepreneurial teaching and learning, how is support given to startups, how the whole relationship is managed with the environment, the international dimension. And then also what we have, and this is just added last year, is about the digital capabilities, because we heard, of course, I think technology at the moment is really transforming the landscape, and then to see how this can also be addressed in a strategic manner. And last not least is about measuring impact. So how you can measure the impact of a higher education institutions, and we see, I mean, this is a very complicated one, but of course, in particular, the ministries, they look at this, they would like to see tools, and I mean, they have a number of things to see what is the impact of a higher education institutions, and I think the higher education institutions, they also, in many countries, they have now a strong interest to show, okay, how they contribute, and I think they do a lot, and the point is, I think sometimes they don't really succeed in showing the value they bring to society, and this is, I think, what we hope that we can really, I mean, help to develop this. Now here, I mean, I don't go through all the different elements here, also for time reasons. One important thing is that the tool as such is really extremely flexible. And what you see here, so it allows the university, if you want, they can have a very systematic, let's say, assessment, analysis of where it stands in its value or in its journey towards a higher education or innovative higher education institutions. To self-assess, it can be, I mean, anonymously done. You can do it, of course, by name. And it's completely, I mean, the results belong to the owners. It belongs to the higher education institutions. It can be done by individuals, but it can be done as a group. And I think this is where the big value is. You can involve with this tool stakeholders. I mean, if you are, for example, a vice rector or rector in the university, you would like to see a little, okay, where we stand. You can involve your staff, your professors, people also, the students, people from the outside, important stakeholders. And you can collect all this data and then see, okay, where it stands. And it will not give you the solution, but it will show you, okay, where there are issues, perhaps the differences also between the perceptions of the people. So it's about self-assessment, so it's not about the hard data. There, of course, you can complement it. But I think it gives you a good basis afterwards to start a discussion with the people, and afterwards, of course, to try to identify, I mean, the priorities and an action plan implement. If you want, you say, okay, I don't want to look at 8 dimensions. I know more or less. I want to look at 1 dimension, just in this, because here we want to address this now. You can do it. And it allows really also universities, I mean, who are highly developed, we see this, and others who are just starting in this. And we have very many different cases. So far, I mean, more than 1,000 higher education institutions, and not only in Europe, have used this and are using the tool. And I mean, some use it really regularly, then also after 1 year, after 2 years, to see a little how developments are ongoing, how things are working. So this is there. And of course, we will have afterwards this the workshop. And I hope really, I mean, there are already a number of higher education inquiries who use it. But of course, I mean, look to see how we could support this development more. And I think an important thing also is that if you do the assessment, afterwards it gives you immediate access also to examples, to material of other universities who have done it, which are considered sometimes at good, I mean, cases of good practice. I don't think that you can just say, okay, I do it like this, but of course it allows you to make contact. And we have now also a community of practitioners who are working together, who can exchange. I mean, there is a LinkedIn platform related to this where now more or less almost 1,000 people are connected and exchange ideas. And we are also organizing regularly events around this. Okay, so I have to move up. So this is just, I wanted to give you an example. I will not go into how the statements look like, how to assess it. And then you assess them normally on a scale between 0 and 5. And this afterwards gives you an idea. But I think what is more interesting, so this is the one, is the results, how it's displayed. So this is, for example, if you do an individual assessment, what you get as feedback afterwards, and then also the link to the different material that exists, to some case studies, but also to some interviews and some guiding notes, what you could do. And this is, I mean, something which we want to develop much more in order to help the universities also to take action. And at the moment, for example, we had just published a call under forward-looking projects under Erasmus Plus, where we had asked for a proposal to see a little how we can build on this. So do the self-assessment, but afterwards take action. And this is just ongoing at the moment. And this is if you do it in a group. So if you say, okay, I involve a number of different stakeholders, then you get these kind of results. And there, of course, the most interesting one, I think, is the spider diagram, where you see then the input from the different stakeholders. And then you can see, okay, here we are very good. All think, then I don't think that you need to look more into it, but here are some weaknesses or here are really differences. Let's look at this more closer and have a discussion and see then, okay, what we can do. And this is then where you can come together and define an action plan. And now I will switch to the country reviews. I will click up all the different things. And you asked me before about the different countries. So this is the second activity that we are doing. And there, together with the OECD and really under the leadership of the OECD, we organize country reviews because obviously universities don't operate in a vacuum. And there we look at the systems. And in this case, the OECD with experts, they go to countries. And before we discuss with them, what are the dimensions you would like to work on? And then they visit 7 to 8, 9 higher education institutions. And all the others are involved into this via providing input and a background report and so. But visits take place really to 7 or 8 higher education institutions. There they go with experts, 1 day visits, collect a lot of information. And here you see so far, we have 5 reviews which have been completed. The last one was one in the Netherlands, and we published these reports. They are available on the AG Innovate website. And at the moment, we have 4 others that are ongoing. So the first 5, it was Bulgaria, which was a sort of pilot. And Bulgaria, there we didn't have the focus on the dimensions, so they are mentioned almost all, except to the digital, because when they did it, it did not exist, this dimension. But so this is, and then afterwards you see the different countries. And we had Bulgaria, we had Hungary, we had Poland, and Ireland, Netherlands. This was the 5 which are so far completed. And at the moment it's ongoing, we have Austria, Croatia, Romania, and Italy. These are country reviews that are at the moment ongoing, and they should be finalized by June this year. Yeah, and then, of course, we will start now a new round until 2020, end of 2020. We would like to have 4 additional countries to have this. And you see here the different countries, what kind of dimensions they look at, between 3 and 4. And this is then where they get the report, and you will see, I mean, if you look at the Dutch report, there's some feedback on all, because we collect also feedback, I mean, from all higher education institutions in all dimensions, but there is a very strong focus on the 3 months, provides a number of recommendations, and of course, what we hope is that then the actions are taken on member state level. So these are the different books. Here you can read them if you want to access them on the website. And now the last thing what we started to do, because this was also really a quest coming out, how can we build on this? Because obviously if you look at the different reports, there are similar findings, there are similar issues. Yeah? Of course there's a context, culture, you say, I mean, obviously place, there is a difference. And so on, we see there's a difference even in within countries. I mean, if you have a university which is, I mean, in a, let's say, in an easy region with a lot of companies around or whatever, or if you have a university somewhere placed where it's much more difficult, so this plays a role. But still, I think there is a context, and this is, of course, what we want to see is how can we support then the different players who were involved into the counter reviews. And we have started to set up what we say a policy learning network, which at the moment involves the countries who have participated in a review from ministries and then also from higher education institutions. We had just started one meeting last November when we had the Austrian presidency in Vienna, and it's really about the support exchange, what they are doing, also following the reviews afterwards, if there are good practices on higher education level, but also on policy level, and then, of course, also if there are common issues. We see, for example, measuring impact is a common issue. At the moment, there's no member states going to say, we have the solution, no higher. And this is, of course, what we want to see. Okay, this is perhaps area where we can work together, join forces, and then afterwards, okay, that the different countries then can take it up. So I think this was it. Thank you very much, and I hope, I mean, you got some ideas.